We bless the Lord tonight. Amen. Welcome to Exchanging Sin for Grace Deliverance Ministry. I am your host and founder, Minister James Baptiste. Amen. And we give God thanks tonight that the Lord has placed a young man in my life who I am just so happy that he is in the studio with us. He's been through his own testimony. And so the Lord touched my heart that we should bring him in and have him minister to the people, because when you hear his testimony, I'm sure that you're going to know that Christians do go through trials, that we were never promised a free pass. I mean, you can ask the Apostle Paul, you can ask Stephen, you can ask Job. Amen. So I don't want to say too much, but we want to welcome tonight our brother Eugene Cooper. Good evening, brother Eugene.
Good evening, brother James.
Oh, we praise the
Minister James.
Amen, amen. Well, you know, here at Choice Gospel, we are not so big on titles. Amen. We believe if you're doing the work, whether you have the title or not, that's all that pleases God. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. You know, what we have found is that sometimes the Christians are hung up on titles, and they are not actually doing the work that the title says they should do. Amen.
Amen.
But we thank God for your humbleness in any way. Amen. So we just want to open up with a word of prayer this afternoon, tonight rather. Almighty and eternal Father, we thank you for your goodness and your mercy. You are God, and beside you there is no other. You are Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, the wheel in the middle of a wheel. Father, we pray that even at the end of this exercise, that your name would be lifted up and your people would be glorified in no other name but in Jesus' mighty name.
Amen.
Hallelujah. We praise you, Lord. We praise you, Jesus.
Amen.
We glorify and magnify you. You are Lord, and besides you there is no other. You are Alpha and Omega, the beginning and
thank
the end.
Thank you, Lord. I love you, Lord, because of who you are. I give you glory.
Amen.
Because of who you are, I give you praise. Because of who you are, I will lift my voice and say, Lord, I worship you because of who you are. Lord, I worship you because of who you are.
And tonight we want to give him glory, amen, because of who he is, amen. So you are joining us again for the first time. If you are, we want to let you know what the ministry is all about. Because Brother Cooper, I always do believe that every ministry should have a mission statement. So that if people take the time out to listen to you, then you need to let them know what it is that you're doing, what it is the Lord has given you to do. So we are going to read our mission statement for Exchanging Sin for Grace. Paraventer, you're joining us for the first time. Here's our mission statement. Exchanging Sin for Grace Deliverance Ministry is dedicated to developing people of God who would balance the kingdom of God. And so we give God thanks, we give God praise, we worship and glorify him, for he alone is worthy to be lifted up and to be magnified. There is no other God like him. He is the Alpha and the Omega. We bless you tonight, Father. So as I said earlier, we are in the studio with Brother Eugene Cooper. Amen. And so the Lord has touched my heart to bring him in tonight. And just this young man is an awesome young man. Brother Cooper, why don't you introduce yourself to the people?
Amen, brother, and thanks again. Well, first of all, I'd like to say hi to my beautiful wife, you know, Shanique Cooper, and my nephew, MJ Maurice Jr., and my father-in-law, and my little niece that's also listening, as well as Zaina. My name is Eugene Cooper, and as my brother just mentioned, I got to know him, and the Lord did a spiritual hookup. Yes, that's exactly right. It's spiritual hookup. So here I am to share my testimony as the Lord leads.
Amen. Amen. So Brother Cooper, a few months back, something traumatic happened in your life. You know, something that I see change and transform you as a young Christian man. And watching you go through this transition and this trial and this testing of faith, my prayer is that at the end of this broadcast tonight, that someone who may be going through something, may have been diagnosed with something and they are lacking in faith, that their faith will increase after they hear what the Lord had done in your life. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. So if you would, just take us to the beginning of this diagnostic and how you received this message from the doctor, and just take us through.
Amen. It started out that I started to lose my vision in both eyes, and I remember as if it was yesterday. So I went over at the doctor because I was sitting at my computer and I noticed right that my eyes, my eyes had a problem holding the focus of, each sentence. It's like when I look at them, they will start to just merge. Like the first, the very first sentence and the second sentence, they would start to just merge. And, I was somewhat concerned naturally, so I went over at the Remosa doctor, and they said, "Well, look, it's nothing really major." So they went ahead and they just prescribed eyeglasses for me to wear. So, I started using it, right? But over the period of time, I noticed my vision wasn't getting any better. As a matter of fact, it kept on decreasing. So I was concerned about that again. And as God would actually have it, I was improperly, diagnosed. So when I was finally diagnosed, it's like I was told that I had what is called a pituitary tumor. And you can imagine, I remember pretty much at the time, my wife now was, we had just started dating. And I was thinking, how can I break the news to actually her? And I remember, I told her, I said, "Babe, I have something to actually tell you." And, and she was like, what? So I said, I was told, I have a brain tumor. And I can imagine, I can even think back now. And it's as if the life in her face just went away, But I forgot to mention, that, it was benign, So when a tumor is, benign, meaning, it's not as aggressive or it's not life-threatening.
Amen.
Right. So, then when I finally actually told her that, so she was like, "Oh, why didn't you say that before? Because you have me actually nervous now." So anyway, so we actually phoned a doctor, and the doctor led us to believe that, look, they were going to go ahead and perform, the surgery, And this is something, that, from what she told us, that this is something, that she's accustomed to doing. And so, I'm no expert, so we had relied pretty much on her expertise. And it turns out, that even though she took me through the process, to put a hole through my skull, to get to the Remosa tumor that was, sitting on my optic nerve that was, affecting my pretty much vision, and stopping the blood flow that, goes through your optic nerve in order for you to actually see. So it turns out, that this doctor, she put me through that, dramatic experience, because any surgery is not natural. It's like it puts the body under tremendous stress.
Amen.
So I went through that, only to find out that the doctor did not do what she was supposed to actually do. You know, and to this day, we're still trying to figure out, like, what did she do? You know? And pretty much afterwards, she actually said to my wife, myself, oh, you know, the surgery has been done, you know, and we took most of the tumor actually out, and you're going to be fine, you know. But thank God for my wife, who was, you know, consistent and said, babe, I think you need, you know, you need to go ahead and do like a follow-up. Because I was still having, you know, problems with my vision even up to like a year after. And thank God that I took her pretty much counsel. And I actually went, and it turns out right, from a second opinion, that the doctor did not do what she was supposed to actually do. And as a matter of fact, the tumor had even grown. You know? So you can imagine me having to go through this experience a second time. So I tell you right now, I did not actually feel it. I felt nothing but, you know, self-pity. Like, you know, why me? And, you know, why? And I must say, you know, my mind was clouded. You know, I think a lot of time when we go through, you know, especially when it has to do with, you know, our health or something unfortunate happened, you know, to us, it's best to not say why, but, you know, rather it's time to really, you know, seek like the most of Lord in an intimate way. Because I tell you, that me actually saying, oh, you know, why me? It's like my whole mind was just clouded.
Amen. So I just want to set this up. So here you are just going along your business, worshiping the Lord, praising the Lord,
right,
flowing in ministry, and out of nowhere comes this diagnostic that tells you that you have a brain tumor.
Right.
Now, what was, when you got this diagnostic, where was your level of faith? What was your communication with God like?
Well, you know, when I actually got it, I think it was a shock, pretty much. It was a shock, you know. It was a shock. And, of course, the devil started telling me, listen up, buddy, I'm gonna actually take you out now. Yeah, I mean, I never forget, it was the entire week leading up to my first surgery. It was just, I mean, a constant. It reminded me of what the Bible says, right? You know, that every morning Goliath came out and he hurled insults at the people of Israel.
Amen.
Now, the devil would just constantly, I mean, just attack on my mind. You're going to die. I'm going to kill you. I'm sick of you. I mean, just, I never experienced anything like that before ever. So that passage of scripture, I really got a chance to see what that was actually like.
Amen. So, you know, sometimes we go through real life situations.
Right.
And, you know, there are so many scriptures that we quote. You know, God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of peace, of power, of love, and of a sound mind. And then there comes a time when you are really faced with a challenge as a Christian.
Right.
And it's not just quoting scripture. Your faith level of faith really goes to a test where it's not just merely saying words. Amen. And so this is what I want to ask. This is what I'm trying to find out from you.
So, I mean, my faith was definitely actually tested, and, you know, right? I had a lot of fear. You know, despite the fact I know I was blessed and, you know, highly favored, right?
Amen.
But I had a lot of fear, right? And, you know, there are a lot of things I felt like, man, I'm not going to get a chance to actually do.
Amen.
You know, as a matter of fact, at the time, I had just met, you know, my now wife.
So here you are, newly married.
No. Actually, we had just started to actually date.
So in the dating.
Yes, in the dating phase. And this, yes. Right. You know what I'm saying? Right. And this actually, you know, I came up and, you know, at the time, it's like, right, I had never dated anyone that I was that excited about. Like, I was excited about my, you know, well, she's my wife now, but at the time, you know, my Ramosa girlfriend, you
Amen.
Know?
And if I may ask, so this was a Christian?
Yeah, yes.
Amen.
Yeah, yeah.
Amen.
Yes, yes.
During
you know?
Dating, it was
yeah,
a Christian.
Yeah,
Amen.
You know, yeah, you know, pretty much. And, you know, so there were a lot, you know, of fear that I actually had. But I must say, I did not lose hope. I did not, you know, my faith in the Lord didn't actually change. I did not stop believing, right? You know, it's like I did not ask myself, right, does God exist?
Amen.
You know, no, no, no. And the reason being is because the Lord took my family and myself through a civil war.
Amen.
Where I have actually, where we, you know, where we had to face death on a daily basis.
Amen.
You get what I'm saying? So, right, so when you're in that kind of environment and you see, you know, people dying, you know, all around you, you know, friends, family, it's like, and as a young man, it started to develop my faith.
Amen.
You know what I'm saying? Right. So pretty much so, I had that to lean back on and say, well, if God took me through that.
Amen, brother. See what
you know, he's not going to bring me to the United States now.
Yes.
With all of the technology actually around. And allowed me to actually die. I say, you know, I refuse to believe this is the God that you know, that I actually serve. I
Amen.
Refuse to believe that. So that was what I fell back on. But as far as fear and doubt, yes, I actually had it. But I didn't for one second, you know, more so believe, right, that, you know, right, is Jesus real? You know, is God real? You know, no. My fear was, man, you know, because of how delicate, you know, the, you know, my surgery, you know, was, I was concerned right then, man, I hope this doctor doesn't, you know, clip like, you know, the wrong cord, you know, because of this, because if they would actually do something slightly off, I could have been remorse paralyzed. And I mean, it's like, look, there's like a list of things. And of course, you know, prior to every surgery, they tell you the different risks and stuff. You know what I'm saying? And once they tell you that, you know, the enemy also uses, you know, he also uses that to, you know, instill remorse and fear in you. And even as believers, if you, you know, a word that is often used in the Bible a whole lot, you know, it's pretty much fear. You know, I remember, right, that even God said, you know, to, right, our brother Joshua, three different times, be bold and courageous.
Yes.
Because I think having fear is a part of the human experience. You get what I'm saying? But it's this, your fear is going to cause you to do two things. Either run away from God or run towards God.
Amen.
You know? And so as far as, you know, as myself, again, because of my experience in the Civil War, and seeing what God actually did for my family and myself, that really had developed my remorse of faith.
Amen.
But that being said, I still actually fear, you know? And I remember, right, that it was the Sunday prior to my surgery, which was on a Monday, that, you know, the Lord just give me this peace.
Amen.
That everything was going to be okay. But
Amen.
I tell you this, it was, I mean, the entire week, my mind was just under constant attack.
Amen.
I mean, all kinds of thoughts, brother. All kinds of thoughts. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. And, you know, and I'm happy I went through that, you know, because those kind of experience, right, they tend to develop you as a believer.
Amen.
You know, you actually need those kind of experiences. Just like, you know, a boxer that's fighting in a championship. You don't get to the championship having not gone through, you know, some previous matches.
Amen.
You know, I even think back, you know, to our brother David. It's like, you know, we all see, right, that David killed, you know, this giant. But prior to that, he went through a bear.
Amen.
Prior to that, he went through, you know, a lion. I mean, listen, you facing a bear, a lion, that's no small task.
True.
You know what I'm saying? So the fact that God brought him through that, that's what the Bible said, right? That he ran towards Goliath. Well, listen, you're not running towards, you know, no giant if God hadn't taken you through those experiences where you had to confront a bear, a lion, all those things, you know? So,
Amen.
Yeah, so, I mean, you know, and man, that civil war, you know, because people were dying, right, you know, from starvation, you know, because it's not like you could just walk down the street and actually buy food and stuff like that, you know. No, you know, and I never forget, I don't know how God actually did it, but not a single day did my family and myself go hungry. And that civil war lasted, what is it, from 1989 until 1990, actually.
Amen. And your place of birth is?
Liberia, West Africa.
Amen. So you have been through some things that we
read
about,
pretty much. Yeah. Amen. Yeah. Amen. You know, yeah, it's like, and I was talking to my wife about that, you know, this morning. I think it was either this morning or sometime yesterday. That, you know, and I don't mean to actually, you know, speak badly of the believers that are in, you know, the developed nations. But is this, I must be honest, our brothers and sisters who are in God's kingdom that live in the underdeveloped nations, their faith are most strong, you know, it's stronger than, it's a lot stronger than some of us who live in the developing nations.
Amen.
You know, because these people, it's like they have to just rely nothing but faith.
Amen.
You get what I'm saying? Nothing but faith. You know, there is no Red Cross that's coming just out the blue to actually do it. No. And, you know, and so I'm very thankful for the fact that the Lord allowed me to, you know, grow up in that kind of environment, and now he moved me on to the United States, where, you know, you could say it's a land flowing with milk and honey, but it still has, it still has its challenges, because I tell you, it seems like everything in this culture is designed to pull you away from your relationship with the Lord.
Amen.
You know?
Amen. Amen. Yeah. Amen. So you've been through the diagnostic, and now you're in preparation for your surgery.
Right.
Amen.
Right.
So how did you interact? What type of people did you interact with? What type of other like-minded believers? Was people praying for you?
It is. It's like, so we're pretty much, I think it's like, right, so just like I was saying, when I was informed, right, by the second opinion from another, you know, from another or neurosurgeon, that the first doctor did not take my tumor out. Instead, the tumor had now actually grown. And if I didn't have that surgery, I would have gone blind. So having to go through that second time again, I was like, oh no. You know, there's nothing in me that desired going. I mean, it's like, I think that was somewhat heavy. You know, but I tell you though, this time, right, the enemy was not attacking my remorse of mine anymore. You know what I'm saying? And I think it was just myself, it was the unwillingness, because I knew that after the surgery, I went through a lengthy recovery process. I mean, the pain, you know, and everything. I said, I don't want to have to go through this again. But I knew, right, if I did not go through this, then I would have lost my ability to actually see again, you know? And I'm a young individual, you know? It's like, you know, I think that there are a lot more years actually left, you know? And I remember, right, my wife said, listen, I understand you don't want to have to go through this again, but I need you to have your vision in order to see our future kids.
Amen.
So, you know, we're going to go to the Lord and ask him for his grace and give you that strength to actually go through it.
Amen. Well, brother, you know, just thinking about that, the Bible talks about not being to be unequally yoked.
Right.
No, the complement in your wife joining and coupling her faith with you to pray rather than being fearful.
Right.
You know, two like-minded people together. You know, she acted as a woman of faith that said, let's turn to the Lord.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. It is. It's like, and I think it's like, you know, even though I kept saying, oh man, you know, I don't want to have to go through this, but it seems like my wife, we hear nothing of it. It's like every time when I said, you know, or made a statement that perhaps was not in line with my beliefs, she just corrected it.
Amen.
And it's like, yeah, I mean, you know, she was constantly just speaking faith.
Amen. So you're saying that there were moments and times where you would have moments of anxiety or fear.
Yes, yes, yes. Yes, definitely.
And because of the godly woman that God has given you when you were weak,
she quoted
scripture and encouraged you in the things of God.
Yes.
Now, those are the benefits
of
marrying someone in the faith like you.
Yes.
Not being unequally yoked.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes. Amen. Yeah. And it's like, and I think also too, right? My wife, because she is a nurse by profession, so it's really amazing because the Lord actually used her to speak to one of her surgeons. Well, actually, she did, you know, her own research, and she found out, you know, the best surgeon that, you know, this time, right, that, like, you know, specialize in this type of surgery, you know, because not every neurosurgeon can perform a pituitary tumor surgery, you know, because, you know, it's very, you know, specific, and it's a very, you know, delicate surgery in nature, you know, right? So she did her research, and she was the one, right, that found my second surgeon who is specialized in doing this kind of surgery, you know. So I'm very thankful that the Lord actually had given me, you know, that quality of like, you know, wife.
Amen. Yeah. Amen. And in speaking to you, I think it was the week before the surgery, you belong to a prayer group where a bunch of men get together and pray 5 days a week early in the morning.
Yes.
And so
the Breakfast Club.
The Breakfast Club. Amen. And so take us through, you know, the brothers praying for you and encouraging you.
Amen. Yeah. It's like, you know, and pretty much, you know, I wanted to actually bring that before the Breakfast Club a lot earlier, but for some reason the Lord had just actually, you know, kept me from doing that.
Yes.
So it was not until, I believe, you know, the week prior that I even actually told my brothers who were part of this Breakfast Club, including your what do you call self?
Yes, amen.
Yeah, you know. And then pretty much, you know, I would just, you know, I was very thankful for the fact that you guys, you know, just came around me. I was anointed and you guys actually prayed, you know. And it's like, I really do believe, right, that going through the second surgery, I was able to go through it, of course, by the grace of God, but not just actually that, but all of the prayers and petition that my brothers in Christ, you know, and sisters in Christ was consistently lifting up on my behalf. So I really appreciate what you guys actually did. I never been prayed for, I believe, by that many people in my entire life. You know, yeah. And that really made a significant difference.
Amen. So what we're saying is that when we hear the scripture that says the prayer of the righteous availeth much.
Yes,
you had fully experienced that.
Yes.
And as we we come to the conclusion, definitely you will see that you were the benefactor.
Yes.
Of God's grace and mercy.
Yes.
And not only standing with yourself, but aligning yourself with someone that's in like mind like you, being married and having a wife that is a Christian, that when you go through your moments of weakness or moments of doubts, someone can come with the word of God and encourage you on.
Yes.
And being surrounding yourself with other brothers that have the same belief like you in the faith, that would hold you up in prayer.
Yes.
And that's important. The circle of people that you keep, that you surround yourself with. It takes me to the scripture that said, blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly.
Right.
Now, brother, imagine if you had worldly friends. You know what I mean? The level of advice that you get may not have been what you received. Because anything that you are dealing with in the scripture, there is something that you could find in the word of God that will encourage you. And if you don't find it, someone you know, that's in your circle will give you a word or would call and pray with you. Tell us how important that is as a young man to be surrounded, and even with older men that were more mature than you in the faith, you have some of those people in your life.
Well, yes. I cannot overemphasize this point. It's like it's very, very crucial to have people of faith that, you know, are like-minded, like, you know, yourself, especially when you're going through, you know, various trials in this life. You know, I mean, you know, it's like trying to put this in words. It's very unfortunate, right, when you have some of our brothers and sisters in Christ, but yet and still, the people that are in, you know, the inner circle are those who don't share the same faith as them. You know, that's very unfortunate because you miss out on a whole lot. You know, I know and I can testify to actually this, and I'm convinced that I was able to go through my second surgery again because of the prayers that were lifted up on my behalf by my brothers and sisters in Christ that shared the same, you know, belief and the same faith as myself. You know, it's like I never felt, you know, alone.
Amen.
You know, and it's like, you know, I know that I had to go through, you know, that surgery, but that being said, I always felt, you know, I always felt as if they, all of them, were actually with me and they were just rooting me on, you
Amen.
Know? Yeah, and so it's like, you know, it gives you a confidence. Yes, it gives you a confidence. And I'm speaking not just, you know, because it's a nice thing to actually say, but I'm speaking from experience.
Amen.
It gives you the confidence.
Amen.
That
so,
all will be well.
Yeah, so Brother Cooper, if there was someone listening to you today that may be getting ready to go through a traumatic surgery, of, or maybe just got a diagnosis with something that is very, very life-threatening, what would you say to them?
Well, I would say to them that it's going to be okay. You know, it's going to be okay, and the reason it's going to be, you know, okay is because of whom they, you know, believe in.
Amen.
And, you know, share that with the people of God that the Lord has placed up in your life, and, you know, ask them to petition our Heavenly Father on your behalf.
Amen.
You know? Amen. Yeah, and it's this. Listen, whatever it is the enemy is telling you, just know that it's a lie. Okay? If he tells you you're going to actually die, know that you're going to live.
Amen.
Because all he says is nothing but lies.
Amen. Amen.
You know? Whatever he tells you you are, that's what's going to happen, just know that it's going to be the opposite.
Amen. Well, you're listening to Exchange in Sin for Grace Deliverance Ministry, and it's something a little bit different tonight if you're joining us for the first time. Amen. We are speaking with Brother Eugene Cooper, a young man that went to a very traumatic surgery where a brain tumor was removed from his brain. Amen. And so we believe that these kinds of conversation is important because we never know what someone else may be dealing with, and letting us know that as Christians, there comes challenges sometimes that you are unprepared for. There comes challenges sometimes, and there's a myth around that when you are a Christian that you don't go through things, you don't go through struggles. Amen. But sometimes we may not be in contact with people, but there are people that's going through some very real life situation battles, and so that we want to encourage you tonight, you know, that whatever it may be, that God is still in control. And yes, you may have moments of doubt, you may have moments of fear, it's only natural, but then just returning back to the Word of God, surrounding yourself with godly people and godly friends, and getting in your Word, it's a means of building your faith. Because certain things that you're going to go through in life, I mean, my brother, I can just imagine, you know, being diagnosed with something like that. And then, you know, you're going to go into the details a little bit, some about how the surgery and what they had to actually do. And you were being prepared to know what it is. And I want to give God thanks for you, because I spoke to you up until maybe the day of the surgery. And I did not hear any wavering in your faith. You trusted God. You believed God.
Amen.
So take us to the day of the surgery and what happened, because I know that as I speak to you when you came out of the surgery, I see a difference in you and some things that you were saying and what your experience was and how you give God praise through this delicate time in your life, and you have now come out to be a better man for it. Your level of faith, your level of relationship with the Lord, just tell us a little bit about that.
Oh yeah, well, okay, so I mean, you know, even the day of, like, you know, my pretty much surgery, it's like I was there, but I wasn't really actually there, you know. I think it's like, right, I was just constantly talking to my Heavenly Father, you know, just telling him actually thank you, you know. And I was ready for whatever it is that was going to actually happen.
Amen. You trusted God.
Yeah, that's what it is. It's like, I said, yeah, I didn't have, you know, right, it's like I didn't place any demand on God. So you know what is this, it's like, you know, whatever it is you're gonna actually do, I am ready.
Amen.
You know, and is this, it's like, even after my surgery, there were times that I you know, despise living. I tell you right now, even after my surgery, I said, you know, Lord, if it be your will, you can take me home now. Because the amount of pain, brother, I mean, I've never experienced pain like that. My gosh, the amount of pain, to the point where you would even actually say, Lord, you know, if you want to take me home, you can take me home.
Well, I tell you, I have not been there to that place, but I can imagine what you're saying. And so now, as you talk about the surgery, you saying that they had to remove this tumor through your nose, not cut your brain.
No. Yeah, is this? It's like, so pretty much, you know, it's a process, you know, in which, right, to go through your nostril, right, and to put a hole up in your skull, and then, you know, to get to the tumor itself. And I remember, right, even after the surgery, the doctor had said to me, he was like, that the tumor had actually grown, you know, to the point where it had flattened out my optic nerve, and they had to delicately peel the optic nerve off of the tumor itself, you know. Yeah, and it's like, right, just to give you, it's like, you know, it was bigger than the size of the tumor, it was bigger than a golf ball. So yeah, I would say, you know, you could say, right, if you took two golf balls and actually rejoined them, that would be the appropriate size of it.
And this is the tumor that was pulled out through your nostril.
Yes, amen. Brother, yes.
And so now you are on, I think, maybe your third week of recovery after the surgery.
Right.
And you said to me that as you sit home and go through the recovery process, spending time in prayer and in the word, that God is ministering to you and have taken you to a different level. Share a little bit about that.
It's like, so pretty much, you know, the week after I actually came home, you know, I never forget. I mean, I'm sitting there, right? I was actually asleep, you know, and I'm in pain, right? And it's like, right, and, you know, I'm taking all of these pain meds. And then the Lord just woke me up. He woke me up, right? He brought me and sat me down into, you know, and brought me into my kitchen and just sat me down. And he started to just download, you know, spiritual truth,
amen,
to my hard drive. And I sat there, and, you know, right, and I said, well, Lord, you know, this is, you know, too much. You know, it's like, I'm not ready, you know what I'm saying? Because, you know, I mean, I was in all kinds of pain, you know. And that's when I also learned that it's not when you feel that you are ready to do something, amen, that you actually ready for it. Yes. But when God says you're ready, then you're ready.
Amen.
You know? And then pretty much the Lord just started to just, you know, talk to me about the importance of understanding, you know, seasons.
Yes.
You know, and as a believer, we go through various seasons of our lives.
Amen.
I think sometimes, right, we are not conscious or most of it, and as a result, we lose out on a lot of things, you know? Right, you know, as a believer, it's like, and, you know, God can give you that wisdom in terms of letting you know what seasons, you know, what season of your life that you actually in, you know, as you know, pretty much as the book of Ecclesiastic chapter 3 says, there is time for everything. It says, right, that God has made everything perfect in its seasons. So, you know, for those of our brothers and sisters who may be believing God for a, you know, financial breakthrough, or, you know, believing God for, you know, a husband or like a wife, you know, perhaps He has you now in that season where you start, you know, that preparation. You get what I'm saying? So, you know, for those, you know, for those of us that want remorse of husbands and actually wives, the question is, are you maximizing the season that God actually has you in? You know, because I remember, right, that even myself, prior to me, you know, or getting married, I had no idea I was going, you know, to even be getting married. But, and I will forget, by the grace of God, the Lord actually took me through, you know, a program called ICB. And ICB, they talk about, right, understanding what, you know, right, understanding what manhood is all about, you know. And so the Lord took me through, you know, that season and started to actually, you know, teach me pretty much, right, prior to getting a wife, some things that I need to be conscious of. You get what I'm saying? It's like, for example, if you want to purchase a remorse of home, it's a process, you know. You want to first now start to pay attention to, you know, your credit report. You know, are you putting away each week or you know, each month, the amount of money that you actually need to have it, you know, a down payment? And to just bring it all back, right, at times as believers, we don't recognize, right, what season we're actually in. And it's this, you know, and whatever it is that God's going to actually do up in your life, he actually does these things through, you know, his seasons. And, you know, God's season is not, right, and it's like, you know, his seasons is, right, it doesn't run in line with the season of our calendars. you get what I'm saying? So, you know, and one thing pretty much, right, you know, the Lord allowed me to even understand that he said that it's important to pay attention, you know, take the time out, right, and understand things, especially as it relates to that period of time that he currently has you in.
Amen. So during the time that you are going through what you were dealing with, preparing for the surgery and
right,
and all that, you recognized what season you were in.
Because, well, I tell
you, yes. Yeah, because recognizing the season kind of prepares you better to deal with it. You know, in natural terms, you know, you're going from winter to a different season.
Right.
And even the way you dress, you have to prepare,
right,
you know, for it.
Right.
Some of us walk around in denial even now, thinking that summer is going to be lasting all along, and there will come a time that is going to change.
That's right.
So when your mind is set to know what season you're in, then you're better prepared, you
right,
know, to deal with what comes.
Right, that's
and
right.
So I give God thanks that he had prepared you to deal with this situation. I mean, had this happened maybe 10 years ago, where your faith level wasn't as it is,
right,
who knows what the result would have been.
Right.
Amen.
Right.
You know, because I remember Jesus having an encounter, and he says, as your faith is, so shall it be.
That's right.
You know what I mean? I could pray for you, but you have to have the faith to believe and trust that what we are praying for is going to happen.
That's right.
Amen.
Amen.
And so, you know, we give God thanks that you are here today. It didn't have to be this way. I didn't have to be here sitting with you. Sorry. Your outcome could have been different.
Yes,
could have been different. And I know that being around you, that your level of faith in God, coming through what you have come through, that has increased your level of faith.
Amen. Amen. Yeah, it's like, you know, and I, you know, is this, it's like, it was after my second surgery that I have really, right, that the Lord, you know, really, you know, share with me what, you know, right, what my purpose is until he calls me home.
Amen.
And that is to, right, that is right, to share the gospel of Jesus Christ.
Amen. And you know? now I know you have a new fire and a new passion.
Yeah, and you know, nothing else.
Amen.
Nothing else matters to me now other than actually that.
Amen.
You know, because something to the Lord even actually shared with me during, you know, that period. It's like, you know, it was a time of just spiritual truth. And it's amazing because, you know, I'm thinking, like, you know, why couldn't you give it to me, you know, prior? But it's like he had to take me through that process.
Amen.
You know, because never before have I ever, you know, despised living. I mean, you know what I'm saying? You know, it's like, you know, never before. But so what I also learned during that process is, and like, for example, you hear this passage, you know, of scripture that says, right, you know, on that day, many would say, Lord, Lord. No, you just said, right, you know, that many would actually say, Lord, you know, haven't we cast out demons in actually your name, and, you know, did this and did that? And he would say, depart from me, for I never knew you.
Yes.
Now, that passage of scripture, right, had always baffled me, you know. I never fully understood it. But after my surgery, the Lord actually broke that down.
Amen.
You know, to me, it's like, right, and, you know, and what that actually is, you know, right, first of all, he's deep, right, when he said, Lord, Lord, haven't we cast out demons in your name? That scripture has nothing to do with addressing the most of the world. That scripture has to do with addressing the house of God. Because understand, the world is not interested in casting out demons in Jesus' name.
Amen.
So it tells you, right, the familiarity of those, right, you know, of those that passage has to remorse to talk about. And, you know, what the Lord actually was showing me to was, you know, people are going to go to pretty much hell not because of the fact that they weren't in church, they weren't in, you know, were different ministries, but it's this. People are going to go to hell, like when he said, right, depart from me, for I never knew you. It's because, Brother James, and I say this, right, and I hope all those that actually listen, please pay close attention to what I'm about to actually say. People are going to go to hell not because you didn't pay tithes, you didn't show love. All these things are important. But people are going to go to hell because what God asks you to address personally in your life, you fail to do so. You know, there are areas in all of our lives that the Lord has spoken to us to address. You know, for example, it's like you taking a test. You have 100 questions on this, you know, exam, and then you have 25, you know, extra credit questions. If you don't address the 100 questions on the test, and you leave that and you go to the extra credit questions, you can answer all of the extra credit questions, you know, correctly. But if you don't answer the questions on the test that you're supposed to, you know, address, you're going to fail that exam. So is this, feeding the poor is a great thing to do. being in various ministry is a great thing to actually do. All of these things, right, are great things. And there are good things in God's kingdom. But what the Lord asks you to personally address in your life, you must address that. And you must do it quick.
Amen, amen, amen. Well, you're listening to Exchange in Sin for Grace Deliverance Ministry. It's about 9:55, so we have about 5 minutes. Brother Eugene, I don't know, there may be someone out there that's getting ready to face surgery, getting ready to face going for some tests. And since the Lord have brought you through this thing, amen, I'm praying that there may be someone that may call in tonight that you may be able to offer them a word of encouragement or even pray for them, amen. So amen. We're going to open the phone line. At this time, the number is 347-663-8638. 347-663-8638. If there's a comment you have concerning our topic tonight, we are talking about standing in faith through the midst of adversity. Standing in faith when the diagnostic or the bad news comes, not to your neighbor, not through the TV about some country or someone else, but when it happens to you, how do you deal with it? How do you discard God? Do you say, God, why me? Do you lose your faith and just run and hide? You know what I mean? We have a real life situation with a young man. I'm not talking about someone that's over 40. A young man just got married and you know, got this diagnostic about the brain tumor and went through the surgery, trusted God, and he's a better man today for it. God has ministered to him through his recovering time at home and so on. God is just speaking to him. We'd speak daily, and he's just getting to a place in God that I give God praise, that after such a thing where some people would be bitter and just say, Lord, why me? So if there is someone tonight that you are facing something medically, something that have been brought up that you have to deal with and you're going through some fear, I'd like to ask you to call tonight. Brother Cooper just 3 weeks ago had a brain tumor removed from his nostrils, and this was a life-threatening situation. He trusted God and God brought him through. He's here today, and I just want to say to you that maybe just a word of prayer can change or transform your level of thinking and faith. So the number is 347-663-8638. Tonight we are just encouraging the saints that as believers you go through things, you go through different situations, but God is still in control.
Amen.
Because of who he is.
You are, I give you glory.
Tonight, if you're going through a medical situation, if you're going through fear, dealing with a surgery, dealing with a test, maybe something that you have to deal with, amen. We have a man that God has just brought through in a miracle, removing a brain tumor from his nostrils. And amen. So we are giving God praise. And because of his experience, I believe that there is something that he can say, amen, concerning whatever you might be dealing with to lift you up. Amen. 347-663-8638. If you have a comment or anything in relationship to the discussion tonight, we welcome you to call the phone line. Amen. You're listening to Choice Gospel Radio, and the phone number is 347-663-8638. We are talking with our brother Eugene Cooper, who have been through a traumatic experience, but God has shown himself to be God again, that he's now a better man for it. The tumor is removed. There is no signs of it, and we believe and we trust God that this is the end of it, and God will continue to minister to him.
Amen.
I will lift my voice and say, Lord, I...
Praise the Lord.
One.
Praise the Lord.
First, can you hear me?
Yes, I can.
One. No, I have a problem. Well, I trust in God, but I went to the doctor. Hello?
Yes, we're hearing you.
Yeah, I went to the...
Are you there? Praise the Lord. Go ahead, ma'am. We're hearing you. Amen. Amen. Well, we have lost that caller. But we give God praise. We give God thanks. Amen. Right. I do pray that she would call back because maybe something that we can pray, and we do know that the prayer of the righteous does avail it much.
You are, I give you glory because of who you are. I give you praise.
Praise the Lord.
Yes, I'm sorry.
Amen.
Hello?
Yes, we're hearing you.
Oh, so he said he could only put injection in my eyes. And I'm telling him, no, I don't need no injection in my eyes. I know the Lord going to heal my eyes. So I just want, you know, to pray with me too, you know. But I trust in the Lord. I know the Lord going to heal me. But he could also, you know, pray with me.
Amen. So you are facing some sort of eye surgery?
He said he want to put an injection in it because the cataract, he cannot do nothing else up with it.
Amen. All right. Brother Cooper, you understand the request?
Yeah, amen. So you would like for us to, like, want to pray for you?
Amen. Well, just pray. Amen. Yes, okay. Just pray for her. Amen.
Or do you have any Father? Yes. Do you have any Father? I lift up my sister request, Lord. I ask you, Father God, that you may heal her, Father, from the crown of her head to the sole of her feet, Father God. I pray, Lord God, that you may anoint those eyes that you have given her, Lord God.
Yes, Lord.
And give her, Lord God, your peace that surpasses all understanding, Father.
Yes.
I pray, Lord God, that in her time of need and trial, Lord God, that, Father God, you may remind her that she is yours, Father God, and that you have her in the palm of your hands. This I ask, Lord God, in your precious name, Jesus Christ, the name that's above all name, I pray. Amen.
Amen. And Father, we come against every spirit of fear and doubt. We bind the spirit of anxiety. That's right. Declare that your peace that surpass all understanding shall be upon her even right now. And we decree that it's done in Jesus' name. My sister, God desires to bring you through. Amen.
Amen.
So just be encouraged. I pray that you were listening, to Brother Cooper's testimony, you know, of dealing with this brain tumor. And it encourages me, and I hope that gives you some confidence to know that if God did it for him, he can do it for you. Yes. Amen?
Amen.
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 So
amen.
After you go through, call us back and tell us about the victory that you have won. We believe that your vision would return 2020. Now, amen. Remember, amen. You have to believe it with us. Amen?
Yes.
All right.
Yes.
So we give God thanks for you. Worship tomorrow as never before. True worship, miracles and sign happens. Amen?
Amen.
All right. You sung excited. You sung excited, and we give God thanks for you. Amen. Yes. So we bless God tonight. Amen. You've been listening to Exchanging Sin for Grace, and we thank our Minister Straker for giving us a few extra moments. Amen. We give God thanks for you tonight, sir, and we pray for many of you that may be dealing with some medical condition tonight. Have faith, believing. Brother Cooper, any last words you'd like to say?
Well, just keep the faith, and it's important. If you an ego, stop flying with pigeons. Fly with your fellow egos. Amen. If you're a child of God, surround yourself by the people who are stronger than you in the faith and is as strong as you in the faith. Amen.
Amen. Good night. You've been listening to Exchanging Sin for Grace, Deliverance Ministry.